As Ryan Baker just perfectly explained, computer science has come to stay. And this has nothing to do with the Matrix movie. Actually, programming has gained more and more bouquets over the years. There are even NGOs aimed at teaching programming to both kids and teenagers. Such is the case of code.org, an organization that considers coding a fundamental subject in their educational program. Its founder, Hadi Partovi, perfectly knows what it's like to learn programming from an early age. Coming from a humble background, he moved from Iran to the United States at the age of 12. Once in the land of dreams, he would start a meteoric career that would make him become one of the top representatives of coding in the world. Hadi Partovi has worked as a general manager at Microsoft. He has been vice president at MySpace, founder of iLike, and usual consultant at Facebook and Dropbox. Today, he is also the CEO of code.org, as well as an entrepreneur and tech investor. It is my pleasure to introduce you to Hadi Partovi. Mr. Partovi, bienvenido a Enlighted.
Thank you very much, con mucho gusto. It's a pleasure to be with you and speak with you today, although I'm in Seattle, Washington. But in this age of Zoom videos, we're all in one place together, it seems. I'm going to speak a little bit about the importance of teaching not only coding, but computer science as part of schools, as part of the curriculum, because of not only the opportunity it gives to children, but also the importance of teaching creativity as part of education. I'll start with a personal story. My story starts with this picture. This is a photo of myself and my identical twin brother. I'm the one on the left. And this photo was taken in Tehran, Iran, when we were young. And the course of our life changed tremendously a few years after this photo, when the country had a revolution and a war with a neighboring country of Iraq. And I spent most of my early childhood in a basement while we were having bombs falling from the sky as Saddam Hussein was trying to fight with the Iranian regime. But my life changed dramatically when my parents brought home a magical gift. They brought home a Commodore 64 that they got actually from Europe, but this wasn't the magical gift. It was a computer, but it had no games, no applications, no software. The real magical gift was a book, an introduction to computer programming. And with the help of my father, who was a physicist, and my mother, who was a computer scientist, my brother and I taught ourselves how to program computers, and we became really good at creating our own games and basically letting our own dreams come to life in that horrible environment. And so when I came to the United States as an Iranian immigrant, I really basically benefited from coming to the land of opportunity and living what is thought of as the American dream. You know, and the American dream isn't just an American dream, it's a global ideal that if you work hard and put your mind and your energy to something, you can make your dreams come true. But that dream is really in a point where people are questioning whether that ideal of opportunity is equal in our world these days. Things are changing very rapidly. Because of the fourth industrial revolution, there's an impact on all aspects of society. And that's not including everybody. And that was true even a year ago or before this pandemic. Now in 2020, with the coming of this pandemic, inequalities are even increased. People with access to the internet are getting ahead of those without access. Wealth, access, geography are all dividing people and increasing the difference between the haves and the have-nots. And this also has an impact on education. At its highest point, COVID-19 forced school closures in 194 countries, impacting 1.6 billion students. And these schools, as they're reopening, haven't all reopened at the same level or in the same way, causing further inequality. And there's this challenge of how do we reset things? How do we give students opportunity? So one thing I talk about is basically the impact of technology on our labor force and our workforce. Regardless of the pandemic, if you look at what technology is doing in our world, if you start with today's workers, projections show that increased automation, robots, machine learning are gradually replacing today's work so that by the year 2040, roughly half of all work that we do today is going to be done by software, by technology, by robots. we all know about this, but what can we do about this? Now, I talk about this in terms of the importance of teaching technology, but is everything about computer science and coding really about how to prepare students for the future of work? Is it only about coding? Actually, no. There's actually much more important and fundamental reasons to teach computer science in school, not just because it prepares students for jobs in technology, but because it helps make school itself better. Computer science in school can help students prepare for life regardless of what career they go into. So in terms of, you think of the preparation school gives you for life, when I went to school, every student would learn, what is the digestive system? How does a light bulb work? Or that A squared plus B squared equals C squared. We teach this to every student, even if they don't want to become a surgeon or an electrician or a mathematician, because it prepares you for life to understand how the world works. In the 21st century, it's equally fundamental to teach students what an algorithm is, or how the internet works, or how an app works. These things are changing society. They're changing every bit of industry. They're changing our democracy. And yet our schools don't teach the basics to students. The other reason to teach computer science in school is preparation for university and career, regardless of what field you go into, not just for the students who want to learn to become technologists. At this point, after 8 years of research on teaching computer science in schools, the research shows that students who study computer science in schools are outperforming in reading, writing, mathematics, and science. They have a better ability to solve problems and stronger executive functioning skills caused by their studying of computer science. They outperform in mathematics even once they reach high school. They have a 17% greater probability of going to university, of entering a four-year college. When they're in university, students who study computer science outperform at problem-solving skills. And then finally, when they graduate, they have higher salaries than their peers who don't study computer science. So if you think about this, this isn't just for the students who go into technology. Computer science helps you learn reading, writing, mathematics, science, problem-solving, and it helps you get into university and get a better paying job. And then the biggest stereotype in computer science has recently been broken. People think that computer science is for those who understand math better. The research now shows that students with language skills are 8 times more likely to predict your success at learning computer science than math skills are, which is great news for language teachers. Teachers who are teaching language in schools can also teach computer science. They are closer to being computer scientists than the math teachers are. And students who have good language skills, especially students who are born or raised multilingual, which many of the students in Europe are gonna have a leg up on students who only learn one language when it comes to learning computer science. The last reason to teach computer science in schools is because it makes school more engaging for the students and more fun for the teachers because how much the students engage. And the reason for this engagement is the creativity. The creativity comes from what you can build using computer science. As early as third grade, students can build beautiful animations. And while they're doing this, they're learning about angles and functions, mathematical concepts that they're using to make beautiful images come to life. By the seventh grade, they can not only play games, they can make their own games. And by 10th or 11th grade, students can make their own apps. And while using this creativity, again, they're learning fundamental concepts of math or science or other subjects as well. Now, when I think about creativity and the importance of teaching creativity in schools, there are so many amazing examples of what students have done with computer science. For example, this student, his name is Dauti Manigat. He's a 10th grader, and his creative idea was to make an app for female abuse victims disguised as a menstrual cycle tracker, so that women could seek help in secret without placing a phone call. Just how creative is that idea? It's just incredible to think about it. Or here's a student, Sophie Saujani. She made an app to help local restaurants share their status at the very beginning of the COVID-19 lockdown so people could know where they could get food. or if you think about collaboration and the importance of teaching collaboration in schools, these students, Hannah Burr and her classmates, created an app to help their friends self-diagnose their mental health. And here's a student, Spencer Applegate. He's in a low-income school in a region where one out of every six friends in his school is homeless, doesn't even have a phone, can't afford food, and he wrote an app to recreate the game Tetris with just 100 lines of code. All of these students have been creating these things in school, and they're taught by their teachers. And the reason I mention this is most of us didn't learn how to do computer programming, how to create technology as part of school. Most of us as adults, we all have phones. We all have the experience of saying, oh, I wish there was an app that did this or that, or I wish they would make something. We should be thinking, I wish I made that app. You yourself can create that app and your children can create that app as long as your school teaches you how to create technology. At this point in the United States, computer science has become the favorite subject in education, right behind dance, music, and arts. It's the thing students want to study the most, and it's not because they think they're going to have high-paying careers, which is also true, but it's because of the creativity. Consider the words of one of the teachers saying, after tryingcode.org in my eighth grade class, I've never, ever seen my students so excited about learning as I did today. That's the way we want students to feel every day when they go to school. Why don't we have students enjoy this feeling of creativity and collaboration every single day while also learning a subject that helps them improve at math, reading, writing, science, problem solving, and future careers? But the problem is most schools don't teach computer science. And it's not only about the schools that don't teach it, it's also an income disparity issue. It turns out that schools with lower income neighborhoods are less likely to teach computer science. If you're in a region that is poor, access to this subject is limited. Now, this isn't a problem that we can't solve. It's a problem that we are solving very, very rapidly. In just a few years, we've reached over 50 million students using the code.org platform, not because the students are using it, but because the schools are teaching computer science using code.org. And our students are almost half young women, almost half are underrepresented minorities, and almost half are students who can't afford their own food, but they're learning computer science as part of school. And what's better is these students have now created over 100 million projects on the code.org platform, exercising that creativity with technology as part of their school experience. Today, if you look at how much this movement has grown in just 7 years, within the United States, all 50 states have established policies to teach computer science within primary and secondary school. More than $250 million have been provided in funding to teach computer science, and more than 100,000 new teachers have begun teaching computer science. But this isn't limited to the United States. This is a movement that is global. Globally, 50 countries have announced plans to teach computer science in their schools, many of them much more ambitious than what's happening in the United States. If you look at countries like South Korea or Saudi Arabia or even Argentina, these countries are changing their education system from primary through secondary school to teach computer science. More than 1 million teachers globally have begun including computer science in their classrooms. And the Hour of Code, a movement that we started just 8 years ago to try just 1 hour of computer science, has now reached 1 billion served, which is one of the fastest growing movements in all of education. Now, this is a global movement that started with individual teachers. Teachers like Juan Lonzano, who just south of where I live, he began deciding that he wants to teach computer science in his school, and he used code.org to start a classroom for computer science. And then he convinced teachers to bring this to the entire school, and then word spread. So eventually the entire region started doing it in the entire district. And then in the United States, all 50 states have changed policies and announced plans. And then lastly, globally, over 50 countries have announced plans for computer science. This is a global movement that we can strengthen and grow to bring this opportunity to all children. but still the majority of schools don't teach computer science. And even with all this progress that we see, there are many, many students that we can help. Now, this year, as we usher in a new decade, a global pandemic threatens to widen the digital divide. We all know that this school year is difficult for education. Instructional time is down, and what's important for schools is to teach the basics, to give the most basic fundamentals so our students don't fall behind. And what's critical even in this year is to remember that computer science is part of the basics. And in an age of distance learning, when students are separated from their teachers, learning from their computers, learning computer science is even more natural. We're also at a point that computer science and the movement to teach computer science is an inflection point. It's at a point where we need to reestablish why teaching computer science is important. It's not just because of the careers or the opportunities. We need to teach computer science because of it's about creativity and collaboration. These are fundamental skills that every student needs to learn, and the best way to teach them in schools is using computer science. We also need to teach computer science that it isn't just about technology jobs. Of course, coding and computer programming lead to the best paying, fastest growing, and largest sector of economic growth. But even after we fill all those jobs, we need to continue teaching computer science because it's a foundational, basic part of education. Lastly, we need to teach that computer science is about solving global problems. Humanity is at a global, is at a historic crossroads, and educators have a role to play. At a time of a global pandemic, computer science holds the key to drug discovery and personalized medicine. At a time when democracy is suffering from a pandemic of misinformation, computer science holds the key to identifying fake news or moderating dialogue. And at a time when racism and xenophobia are colliding with a global economic recession, computer science holds the keys to opportunity, and teaching computer science equitably can build bridges across populations. When I learned computer science, classroom was about calculating the Fibonacci sequence of numbers. When Mark Zuckerberg learned computer science, it was about sharing information on the internet. Today, we need to shift computer science class to be about curing diseases, cleaning oceans, aiming for gender and race equality, and addressing global poverty. These are some of the largest problems of our time, and the only way the future generation will address these problems is with the power that technology gives us, and we need to teach them that power as part of their education system. And my final point is that computer science is about community. The community of teachers that have built this movement from just 1,000 teachers to 1,000,000 teachers has really changed education in schools all around the world. 7 years ago, computer science was only being taught by thousands of teachers in the United States and hundreds of teachers in other countries. Now there are millions of teachers teaching this in schools, showing that we can change public education globally to prepare the next generation for the technology that is going to reshape our century. This movement is still small. If you look around the world, 90% of schools still don't teach computer science. Now in America, it's almost 50% of schools do it. But if you look in countries like in India or in rural Latin America or in the corners of Africa, most schools don't teach computer science. But 20 or 30 years from now, every school will be teaching it. And the people who are going to bring this to schools, who are changing education, are the teachers. Teachers are the most important players in this movement. They're doing the most important job in the world. So I want to close and thank the 1.5 million teachers who've been using code.org. You are changing the face of computer science. You're changing the face of technology, and you're preparing the next generation to help solve the global problems that we face today. Thank you so very much.
What a powerful story, Hadi. But I would like to ask you to stay here for a while, because here there is someone who wants to talk to you. She's someone really interested in educational processes and systems. Please welcome Ainara Zubillaga, Director, Education and Trainer of Fundación Cotec. Ainara, you have some questions for Hadi Partovi.
Thank you, Marta. And thank you, Mr. Partovi. It's a pleasure for me to have the opportunity to share this time and to have the opportunity to ask you some questions with one of the most important voices related with technology and education. In your presentation, you show that computer science is one of the favorite children's subjects with art, dance, and music. And this is very interesting because this is how to confluence two disciplines that, in principle, it seems completely different. I mean, the digital dimension and the artistic dimension. So how do you think we can combine them? I mean, we are talking about maths, engineer, and science, of course, but we are talking also about arts now. So how can we combine all these disciplines in order to promote and to improve the educational process?
That's a wonderful question. And by the way, one thing I didn't say is that the next favorite subject after art and dance and music and computer science is creative writing. And it's because students enjoy creativity. Everybody enjoys creativity. If I told you, I want you to memorize 10 things or I want you to draw a picture, of course you'd rather draw a picture. And how do we now teach these things with computer science? That's actually an easy problem. And it's part of why code.org has become so popular in schools is because the challenges we teach in computer science using our curriculum combines art or music or even dance. My favorite example is we have an activity called the code.org dance party. And what it is students can use coding to choreograph a dance. They can choose the dance moves, how to put the dance moves together, timing it to the music, controlling the dancers with their keyboards. And so you're making a dancing game. You can make a multiplayer dancing game to play with your friends, and you code it yourself. You choose your song from your favorite music. And so for students, that's bringing music and dance and creativity and a game all in the classroom. And they're also learning coding skills as part of creating that. Now that's something we do, but there's other, you know, there's a platform built by a professor in the UK called Sonic Pi that is teaching students to create music using code. So they're becoming actually DJs, but instead of spinning discs, they're writing code to generate new sounds that have never been heard before. So everything that's happening in the world of creativity and entertainment, when you look at the actual world of industry, is using technology. Mm-hmm. All of today's movies are using computers for digital effects. And students themselves are very comfortable with this. If you go to any 13-year-old kid, if they've had enough time on a phone, they know more about video editing and all sorts of things than most adults do. And that's why we should teach them computer science as well, because they learn it very quickly. Just like a student learns a language much easier when they're young than when they're an adult, learning computer science is the same way. It just feels native and natural to them, even though as adults, we're scared of this technology.
And you point out that computer science is out of school, is out of the educational system. And I ask you how we can integrate computer science into the curriculum, in the curriculum of the future. How do you think is the best way to do it? Maybe as an independent subject or in a transversal way through different subjects or a specific project? So how we can enter the computer science and the programming into the curriculum of the future?
This is a very good question. It's such an important one because if you look at school, if you go anywhere in the world and look and see what people are teaching in classrooms and compare the classroom of today to the classroom of 200 years ago, a lot of things have changed. People have telephones that are smartphones. Some people have smart screens. You know, instead of a blackboard, there's a whiteboard. But one thing hasn't changed. What we teach is the exact same stuff. How we teach is different, but we're still teaching reading, writing, math, chemistry, biology, history, the same exact subjects, and mostly the same curriculum as 200 years ago. If you erased all of that and said we have a blank slate, what are the most important skills for students to learn? Certainly computer science would be in that list. We don't need to pick the list that was written 200 years ago. But the question is, how should we teach it? Should it be a separate course or integrated? And I think of it similar to math or reading and writing. When you learn math, reading, and writing, those are separate courses. You have a math class and you have a literature class, but then you use your math in physics or in chemistry class. You use your reading and writing in history class because they are linked into the other subjects as well. And this is true of computer science as well. It's a standalone subject, but you can use it in science class, you can use it in art class, you can use it even in literature class.
Unfortunately, we only have time for one more question, and we have to talk about the impact of the coronavirus in education. And most of the schools have closed during approximately 3 months. And in this scenario, what do you think is the role of the computer science in this post-COVID educational scenario?
Well, obviously, this pandemic has been devastating for everybody, but especially for education and especially for the students who haven't had devices or internet at their homes. And one of the worst, saddest parts of the pandemic is that it's increased the digital divide because families with easy internet access have stayed connected in communication, and also the students have been learning in a way that students haven't been. The one good news coming from this pandemic is teachers globally are learning technology skills at a pace they haven't before. You know, a year ago, teachers in the world didn't all know how to use Zoom or video conferencing. Some of them knew how to do it. Now, almost every teacher in most developed countries is learning all these technical skills to manage a digital classroom. And the students themselves, they're learning it very quickly as well. So even in schools that traditionally had very little technology, they're learning to embrace technology because they have to do it. And so once school reopens, there's much more opportunity to include not, you know, Zoom teleconferencing, but teaching computer science, because now the teachers are more comfortable with technology and they recognize that it plays a role in education. So even when the students are together in a classroom, they can keep some of the computers and use that time to teach computer science, computer programming, and creating technology. And I believe this pandemic is closing some doors and widening some divides, but I also think it is opening a door for increased not only use of technology in education, but teaching how that technology works and how to create it. And I think that's going to be one of the best things that comes from this pandemic.
So thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Partovi, for your presentation and for sharing with us your reflections. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. It's my pleasure.